Welcome to Pantisocracy, and this is your host, Miss Panti Bliss.
Thank you for that warm greeting.
Hi. You're prettier than most of our audiences. This episode is a bit like, well, your ideal dinner party, we hope, where there's, you know, interesting and fun people having smart conversations. And first up, please, a warm welcome for Mr. Anthony Keigher. I said that weirdly because I've known Anthony for a number of years. Because he's a homosexual and I'm a homosexual and all homosexuals know each other. But I never really thought before whether it's Keigher or Keigher until I had to say it on radio.
It's actually Keigher. Silent G.
Silent G? Wow. That's the absolute height of notions. He is a self-described former drag clown. He's an uber-colourful and, I shall say, sexy performer. And his latest gig is called Sodom and Begorrah. So that tells you everything you need to know about him. Please welcome Anthony. Next Anthony over here is another, well, London-Irish celebutante. It's Brona Titley. She's a comedy writer and actor whose wit and words play into shows like 8 out of 10 Cats and into the mouths of people like Tracy Ullman. So, please, another warm welcome for Brona. And then over here on this side, all the way from County Cork. Well, you're a native of County Cork, but not living there at the moment. It's Iarla Ó Lionáird. Iarla here has been performing since he was a small child, and he now tours the world, you know, singing with the super group, I think is what we were referring to them these days as, the Gloaming. And he splits his year these days between his hilltop house in Inistioge in County Kilkenny and the ivory towers of Princeton in the US of A. So please welcome Iarla. And the fourth member of our quartet is Caoimhe Butterly. Now, Caoimhe is a woman who has packed about half of the world into her life because she was born here in Dublin, grew up in Canada, and has worked for various social justice causes around the globe, from Zimbabwe to Mexico. And she's now living back in Dublin here, but she works with the refugees and migrants here in Ireland, but also in Greece and Lebanon. So thank you for being here, Caoimhe. Now, before we get to our wonderful guests, first of all, I get to talk to you. And I'm going to talk to you today about the idea of home, because that is what we are talking about today. And you see, is there anything more Irish than leaving Ireland? Leaving has sort of been bred into us over the generations. Our history and our ambition and our instinct for survival, you know, all favoured the leaving gene. You know, fight or flight. Well, if the fight's unfair, the odds uneven, your chances blighted, that's a pun, well, no contest, flight, fast track, priority boarding, armrest down, place mask over nose and mouth. But there's a funny thing about this lichen-covered, you know, peat-smeared rock of ours out here in the Atlantic. You can leave it, but it never leaves you, even if it pushed you out in the first place. It leaves a kind of brackish, stubborn stain that's almost impossible to remove entirely, you know, a biological mark. That's developed resistance to potions, both bio and non-bio. You can paint over it, you know, shiny new Dulux skin, you know, but eggshell, matte or gloss, it bleeds through your carefully chosen elephant's breath. You know, paper over it, well, you can try, but, you know, flocked or embossed or star-spangled striped, you know, maroon or royal blue, or even parchments, watermarked, you know, cards, dollar green, or papers that permit pasted right on newly minted citizen chests and still our birthmark bleeds through. You know, being Irish is a bit like being a stick of rock. You know, the kind that mothers are pestered for at fun fairs and seaside towns, from Bray to Salt Hill, Brighton to Coney Island. You know, because it doesn't matter where you pick us up or even where you break us open, because wherever you break us open, right down the centre, it'll still say Ireland. You know, I left after college. Though unlike many generations before me, or many people before me, I didn't leave in a veil of tears and gnashing of teeth. I was not a reluctant leaver. You know, I didn't just leave, in fact, I ran. I ran as far as I could away from this stifling rock, and I got as far as Japan. And as far as I was concerned at the time, I wasn't going back. And I didn't miss it. Sure, there were people that I might have missed and occasional things, but I didn't miss the place. And why should I? It definitely didn't miss me. Didn't even like me at the time. And at the time, it made very clear that it didn't miss me or want me. And I was just fine with that, or at least I convinced myself that I was. Not that I thought too much about it. I didn't really have the time. I was spending my time, you know, running around Tokyo, running riot, and discovering I did actually like me. In fact, it felt like I was really meeting me for the very first time. I mean, the real me. Because, you know, back on that windswept Atlantic rock, which had been so contorted by its own particular history that it somehow managed to be both looking inward and backward at the same time, I hadn't really been me. I'd only been a potential me. A potential but unrealized me, you know, a matte gray, monotone, caterpillar version of me. But in Tokyo, under the grow lamp heat of a billion neon lights, I metamorphosized, like my friend Dorothy. You do know I'm a friend of Dorothy's. At home, I'd been in black and white. But in Oz, I was in technicolor and stereoscope. But unlike Dorothy, I was in no rush to get back to dull Auntie M. In fact, I blamed poor old Auntie M for my caterpillar years and wanted nothing to do with her or anyone related to her. And if one did wander into my Oz, I would go out of my way to avoid them. You know, Ireland and St. Patrick's Day are neither well known nor much marked in Japan. But a few years into my Tokyo adventure, one March 17th, a date which I'd hardly even registered, to be honest, you know, arrived at the huge, you know, achingly cool nightclub where I was working at the time. It was housed in a seven-story industrial building, you know, large enough it was for me to fully unfold my still new iridescently colored butterfly wings and flit about from table to table under the giant disco ball. Well, in fact, that was what I was paid to do, you know, to touch down on a table and dazzle its guests with, you know, my flashy colors and my sparkling bon mot. But anyway, on this particular night, this particular March 17th, when I arrived, the manager, he said to me, "You're from Iceland, right?" And I looked at him suspiciously and nodded slowly, agreeing that, yes, I was from Iceland, which is something I had learned to do in Japan because it's just simpler and easier than trying to explain that Ireland and Iceland are different places, you know, in the same way that I also learned to just agree that, yes, I must be very good at skiing. I was from Iceland. I thought so, he said, and he told me that he was expecting in a large group from Iceland tonight. They had reserved some tables because they were celebrating Emperor Patrick's Day, and so that would be fun for me, right, to be able to celebrate the birthday of our Emperor Patrick with other people from Iceland. You know, why hadn't I told him it was Emperor Patrick's Day? Happy Emperor of Iceland Day. Now, like I said, the club, it was big. You know, it had maybe 60 or 70 staff at a nighttime, and even I impressed myself that it only took me about 20 minutes to cover all seven stories and tell every single member of staff that they were not to tell the group from Iceland that I was also from Iceland. And never mind why, you know, just don't mention it. If anybody does ask, just say I'm from Australia. Of course, at the time, I hadn't learned yet that I was indelibly marked by this place, and even the colored lights of a dance floor on the other side of the world were enough to see right through me and reveal the brackish watermark of home. Now, things change, of course, and, you know, I changed, and Ireland changed, and I wanted to be part of that change, and that stubborn stain of Irishness started to itch in a way, and all the scratching in the world, it turned out, wouldn't ease it. And so, you know, to no one's surprise more than my own, I suppose, I found myself back here. But I was back in an Ireland that was shape-shifting, you know, slowly, occasionally, rapidly, you know, in fits and in starts, not altogether painlessly and not without missteps, but it was changing nevertheless, reshaping itself, you know, into a place with space for someone like me. Now, Dorothy and I had both had to leave Kansas to discover our full potential. You know, to realize that we could take on witches, we were as smart as any Emerald City wizard, you know, to find heart and courage and friendship on the yellow brick road or A1. And to discover that all along, home had actually been right under our feet, just three heel clicks away. And like Dorothy, I did click my heels together and back to Kansas, but my Kansas had finally gotten fed up of being in black and white and was digitally colorized. But we didn't have to go back to Kansas, Dorothy and I. We chose to. You know, we could have, like some of my guest Dorothy's today, we could have chosen instead to make Oz home We could have taken that, you know, indelible stain of Kansas and decorated it and celebrated and made a house and a home out of it. A little bit of Kansas in the middle of Oz. You know, maybe a country cottage on the edge of the haunted forest, just off the yellow brick A1, or maybe a chic apartment in a gleaming tower smack bang in the middle of Emerald City. Because it turns out that Glenda the Good Witch was right all along, and home has always been right under your feet. So today we're talking about the idea of home, and what's interesting is that all of you did something that I didn't, and you sort of made your home wherever you were, in a way. And so let's start with you, Anthony. So you're from County Roscommon.
Woo!
A comic man like myself. We're neighbouring. And you felt, I'm taking this because I've seen your show, so you felt that you couldn't really be Anthony in the same way that I felt that I couldn't, at the time, be me here at home. And you went off to London, as so many Irish people have done over the last few generations. Tell me about it.
I mean, it wasn't even about sexuality for me. It was just sort of the sense of, I mean, I really relate to you in the sense that you kind of left for Japan to create and create yourself. And I did something very similar where I went to London and really started from a really sort of an empty box. And
yeah, but Roscommon is home.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
Is that still in your mind home, or have you made another one?
I think Roscommon is home. Like, I was just there to surprise my mum for Mother's Day, and it was very grounding. And it's not really the community around it that I'm fond of. It's just my family, you know?
Yeah. Well, I hasten to add, that doesn't mean you hate the community around you. but is it your house and your family?
And the farm and the cows and the bog.
And you think it's indelibly your home?
I feel best there, but I'm also in London and that is my second home. But also now I'm kind of in this sort of in-between state of like, oh my God, UK is imploding. And then in Ireland we're sort of laughing at London and I'm sort of like stuck in this sort of in-between space.
But, I mean, what was it like for you to be growing up in Roscommon?
I always felt like I was kind of a magical child. You know, I did believe I had magic powers. That was my coping mechanism. I would sort of like turn invisible, control thing, you know, freeze people and all sorts of sort of, I had my own little world. And that's how I dealt with the kind of constant sort of burden of like being a little bit different and treatment from adults and people around me and that kind of thing.
I can appreciate that because we have a similar experience in some ways. I'm from County Mayo, small town, and I always felt weird. And sometimes I think we blame that all on our sexuality or, you know, whatever. But of course, don't all kids feel like that?
Yeah, I don't think it's, I think it's just I was a weird child.
And a weird
adult. A weird sexy adult.
Now, Iarla, your home is Cork.
It was.
Yeah, yeah. Well, for starters, there was 12 kids.
12 kids, yeah. In fact, I just spoke to my mom today, and she had all of her 12 kids before her 34th birthday. I mean, I'm shocked.
And it was in Coolay.
In Coolay in West Cork, a place that had a sort of an identity within the music world. And so anybody that came from it had a sort of a watermark. You know, I remember I came to Dublin to go to university like anybody else does. Well, that was a huge change for me because I grew up on a farm very high, far away from the nearest village.
And steeped in traditional Irishness, right? I mean, there was...
Traditional everything.
Yeah.
High-grade Catholicism, fully leaded kind of going to church.
And Gaelgore.
Oh, yeah, the whole thing. So, you know, coming to Dublin was... It wouldn't sound like it today to people, but it was tremendously exciting.
Mm.
And strange. And hyper-realistic. And I fell in love with Dublin. I lived in Dublin for about 15 years.
Mm.
And I still think of myself as partially Dublin, having spent that much time here.
Yeah.
I'm very comfortable in Dublin. But back then in the early 80s, it had a certain darkness to it.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, I was here in the early 80s. And so grey.
It was very grey.
Unrelentingly grey.
But there were a lot of pubs. And there was. I mean, I certainly spent enough time in them to know that they were fun at times. But
yeah.
I grew up in a very confined sort of world, but I had a sort of a visa in that I could navigate within the music world pretty easily.
You were also from a very musical family, right? I mean,
yes, my mother's family were known as traditional singers for generations. In a sense, there were sort of expectations maybe as was part of that, which was uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. I did a lot of the competitive singing that people do, and I grew tired of that by the time I was about 16. It was an enormous pressure. Then I did what other people do. I went into bands and all sorts of kind of various types of music making.
The kind of stuff that your parents were supportive of, or?
I never told them much about it, to be honest.
And you're definitely from Cork.
Yeah. No, I mean, they're very supportive of everything I've ever done. I'm very fortunate. But would they always have been supportive of everything I was doing? Probably not. I mean, how could they be? I was like everybody else. I was against going home for years. I couldn't bear the thought of going home. I wanted to leave home. Mm. I mean, my house was very crowded.
Yeah.
You know, I remember when my sister left for college, I remember complaining to the management, you know. I said to my parents, this place is going to go to hell.
Because there was 10 boys, right?
10 boys. I mean, and it did go to hell.
Oh, my God.
I mean, there were fights and, I mean, there was a lot of aggro. So I was kind of a quiet chap, and I couldn't wait to get out. But then when my late 20s, I started to spend more time at home. I love going home.
And do you still sing as a sort of a 12-piece or whatever? No. You were all in the choir, right?
No, yeah, but we never sang as a kind of a family. That never...
There is a whole missed opportunity there. Well, now, Caoimhe Butterly, your experience couldn't be more different than that.
Slightly.
Yeah, so you were born here, but then your mother went to Canada, where she fell in love with a UN economist. Mm. After that, it was all over. Your home was a passport.
Yeah, I'd say my trajectory was sort of the opposite way around, in the sense that I was born here, and then my mum was a single mother at the time in late 1970s Conservative Ireland, and she immigrated to Canada. Although the father who raised me was from Dublin as well, so my three parents actually met in the Simon community in Ireland in the late 1970s, and ended up, all being very much a part of my life in very different ways. So both my biological and my nurture father.
Your nurture father is the UN economist. Mm. Yeah.
Although that was sort of later on in life. They were both quite precarious migrants in Canada for most of my childhood. Mm. And so our experience was very much, to begin with, one of sort of working class migrants in Nova Scotia. And I went through an education system that was well ahead of its time, in the sense of, I was just thinking, it's probably the antithesis of what a lot of you experienced, but just in the sense of being extremely politically progressive and really great in terms of racism and homophobia. And it was just an extremely diverse school of a lot of children from sort of first generation migrant backgrounds from across the globe. Oh. So it was sort of when I was older that my dad started working sort of with non-governmental and then governmental organizations as well. And my mother, who's a psychotherapist who works with trauma, her job was actually the job that took us in places as well.
Because you grew up in places like Mauritius
Mauritius and then Zimbabwe. And then I moved to New York, and then I worked in Latin America for a number of years, in Mexico and Guatemala and Haiti, and then eventually in Palestine, Lebanon,
like,
and
that's
briefly
a lot.
In Syria. Yeah. And then I came back 7 years or 8 years ago. So I think my trajectory has been different, in the sense that it's been in the last 8 years that I've been beginning to sort of, just get a sense of much more rooted identity in a country that sort of occupied, for lack of having to go into that whole long lineage of sort of countries, when asked where I was from growing up, I would just say Ireland.
Yes.
And yet my connection to Ireland was very ephemeral. It was through sort of visits here every few years.
And is that what you always say? You never said that I'm Canadian.
To begin with, up until a certain age. And then when we left Canada, we never went back. So I left at 12. So my childhood was very rooted there. And a lot of sort of my memoryscape of childhood is very much in Nova Scotia. But as sort of time went on and the place that I came back to was here, it sort of unfurled as a deeper sense of identity. And when I came back, I had come out of sort of witness and working on ambulances in a few quite, very painful war contexts in Gaza and other contexts. So I came back with a real need just to ground myself in something beyond the intensity of witness of injustice and war. So I went to Inishmore and I spent about 9 months just trying to ground myself with a more elemental energy around sort of seascape. And part of my spirit was yearning for maybe, just the emotional intimacy and community and vibrancy of my life before that in Latin America and the Middle East and other contexts.
Yeah, because it's one of those things most people never think about, where are you from?
Yeah.
Most people just know how to answer that question. And so we spend no sort of psychic energy on it. Mm. But yours has all been
scattered.
Where the hell am I from?
Yeah.
Well, one of the things I was sort of getting at in the monologue there was about deciding where your home is. And in a sense, you didn't have an address like most of us sort of, so we can sort of make that decision easily. But in a way, you came back to Ireland, discovered at 7 months pregnant that you were pregnant.
Yes.
What?
No.
And then
I didn't know that
had your son. And my impression is that in a way,
Your home now is wherever he is, and that has
sort of... Yes, in terms of anchor, but it was more, I felt, because I still work in refugee camps in Lebanon in different contexts, so I take him with me oftentimes, so he's used to a fluidity of... He's very adaptable, but on a spiritual level, he's been my anchor, I think, in the sense that through him... Yeah, I've sort of relearned in a way through watching his process, you know, within this country, but of identity formation, and also recognizing in a way that you can hold multiple identities, you know. Yeah. And but yeah, no, he was the primary reason initially for staying, but then it just became it's for me probably similarly to how you described it, but a place of grounding and calm. And perhaps maybe because when I do work with refugee communities, yeah, it is in quite intense contexts, I come back here and I literally feel it's almost, and I don't mean monastic in its religious connotation, but I feel that just the stone and the bog sometimes and the seascapes and the gray even, I find extraordinarily grounding and calming, and it resonates on a spiritual level.
Now, Brona, you went to London too. Now, you are a Northside girl.
That's
from
right.
From a super academic family.
Pretty much, yeah. I grew up in Glasnevin, home of, you know, the botanical gardens and the Met Office.
And your father's an Alan Chisholm professor.
Yes, he is professor of the Irish language and a writer and a very smart man. It was an awful shock for him when I came along and was much, much smarter than him. and obviously way more modest. And I'm one of five kids. And I mean, we lived in that house in Griffith Avenue from, I think we moved in there when I was about two. Mm. And I absolutely loved Dublin with every fiber of my being. Like, I felt like such a Dublin chick, and I just thought Dublin was the best place in the world, and I actively said I will never leave Dublin. And I think I thought I was such a city girl as well, like, oh, drop me in the middle of Shanghai and I'd know my way around.
Yeah.
You know, just because I could get the bus from Glasnevin into Grafton Street. Really, like, high opinion of myself. And I went to school on the Old Finglas Road primary school, and then went to secondary school in the centre of town. And then I went to Trinity and studied drama and English there. And it was only when I realised that I wanted to train as an actor that I was like, oh, I might need to go somewhere else, because there was only two places in Dublin at the time where you could train. And I had already studied at both of them as a kid. Yeah. And I was like, they do not want to have me back.
The ambition was to be an actor first.
Yeah. I mean, I never really thought about writing until I sort of fell into it as a way of writing parts for myself. And so that kind of came.
But when did you find out you were funny?
Birth, I think. Yeah. So I applied to and got into Lambda, which is a really lovely school over there. And I was doing a 2-year course, and I was absolutely convinced that I would go over, train as an actor, and then the second I graduated, probably the same day, I would be back on that first flight, because I really loved Dublin theatre and I loved the community, and I was just dying to come back here and make work. And then I think I was in London about a week when I realised, yeah, very quickly, oh, I'm not going home. And now I have 2 years to figure out how to break it to my mother.
But what was it about London?
So I think it was just the size. I did drama at Trinity, and I went to see everything that was on in Dublin. And I feel like at that time, which is over 10 years ago now, if you went to the theatre twice a week, you could see everything that was on. And when I got to London, I realised that there was sort of like 40 theatres within spitting distance.
Yeah.
I was like, ah, okay, there's going to be more work here and more opportunity. And as it turns out now, like, to skip to the present, I work in TV comedy, and there is just such a huge industry over there. Mm. Like, I think RTE make, I don't know, maybe 4 comedy series a year. And in a week, because I'm freelance, I'll be across 4 different TV comedy shows. And so it just became about size. Not that size matters.
but
in this context, size really matters. And also in the bedroom.
But are you there, you know, then you just purely for career reasons, and you would move back here if there was a huge TV industry here? Or is it more than that?
I mean, it's a good question. Like, I do come back all the time. I come back, you know, 5 or 6 times a year. And, like, I can go from my house in London to my parents' house in Dublin in under 3 hours. Like, it takes me longer than that to get my hair done sometimes. You're the same, I'm sure. So I love Irish people, and I love being near the sea, and I love, you know, the crack is kind of different over here. So I feel like if there was a huge industry in TV comedy here, it would be much more likely that I would be there. But because that doesn't exist, and that's kind of like a hypothetical. I am in a place where that industry is, and you know, now I've bought a house and I've taken a wife, and this is
I lazily referred to her as being gay earlier, and she corrected me very quickly.
I was like, Panti, hashtag bi visibility.
Yes,
I mean,
I'm sorry for
Panti,
erasing you.
Get woke. That's what I said.
And well, actually, it's very interesting who you're married to in this context of this conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you are married to an English girl who comes from an Asian Sri Lankan background.
Yes, that's right.
And I hate to even get into Brexit already, but England has either just changed or it's revealed something about itself that we had ignored for a while.
Yeah.
And you have an Irish accent, and
thank you.
Your wife doesn't look, you know, like a Brexiteer might want an English lady to look, you know.
Interesting.
So do you still feel London's home?
Well, it's a great question, because I am such a city chick and I love to be where there's galleries and theatre. And my partner, she grew up in the Lake District, and she was kind of the only Asian in the village, and she was the only gay in the village. And she certainly felt that a little bit, but she still really loves the countryside. Yeah. And so we've been together nearly 10 years now, and she's kind of often said, oh, I'd love to move to the countryside. And I've often said, oh, no, I just smashed a cup, so there's no way we can have that conversation. And really try, because I just do not want to leave London. And then when Brexit happened, it did.
Okay, we're going to have the Brexit conversation now. And then we'll have a song to erase it from our memory.
I mean, you did bring it up, so you can't, pretend it was me.
Has it changed how you think about your adopted home? Or are you in your London bubble with your partner and your TV comedy writing? Like, has it changed for you?
It definitely has. And also, because some of the shows that I write for are topical comedy shows. Mm. So I will have to digest the news cycle and then find a way to make the eighth vote that week about Brexit entertaining, when it's just not on any conceivable level.
It is entertaining and so on some conceivable level.
Yeah, sure. I mean, seeing the Brits tie themselves up in knots, it's very entertaining. I still feel like I'll be able to stay in London because, you know, I'm a privileged Irish person.
Yes,
and
do you want to stay in somewhere that the relationship has changed?
I do, just that's where my career is. And unfortunately, it's a career that I couldn't have here currently.
Yeah. And then now, Anthony, you're also living in Brexit land. Has it changed how you feel about your adopted home?
I run a club night called Sodom and Begorrah, but a lot of the Brits come because they feel much more comfortable with us, you know, liberal Irish people, because we've kind of moved forward so much. But then at the same time, I don't really think I could ever live here. London is kind of a vehicle for me. You know, it's anonymous. I feel, as a self-proclaimed attention seeker, I love that no one knows who you are. And I find that really freeing. And
well, you know, when I was younger, I definitely felt that. But my feelings evolved all the time. God only knows how I'll feel about it next week. But, you know, the things that I used to not like about, you know, Dublin or Ireland, you know, I've grown to appreciate as I got older. And size is one of them. But you know what I mean? I didn't like when I was younger that, you know, you could walk into town and bump into people. And it felt like home, because you were just bumping into people. Whereas now I love it.
Oh, I hate that. A teacher from when I was in secondary school at the train today, and I literally just put on my fab jacket and was like, like, I just don't want to engage. It's not because I don't love people, but it's just this sort of, what are they going to say to me? I look really funny. I'm wearing like loads of colours. Oh, it's going to be like a bit uncomfortable. You know, I like being at home and then evaporating into London.
Really, you are living in the United States of America, which has its own sort of issues, you know, about identity and all that. Now, you're in Princeton, so it's all very aghast at Trump in Princeton.
Yes.
I should clarify, he's not just homeless there. I mean, he's working there in an august university.
I remember I was at a concert in Princeton when the election was happening. Everybody was super confident that Hillary would win because this economist in Princeton had made the prediction. He's the world authority on predicting outcomes of elections. And he even said that he would eat a bug if his prediction didn't work out. And he ate the bug a few weeks later. And in fact, I remember getting emails from colleagues saying, the meeting is on at 11. We will not be talking about the election.
Mm. Wow.
There was a lot of that going on. And in fact, I rarely, if ever, talk about it in Princeton because nobody wants to talk about it.
Yeah.
So it's like the big kind of elephant that nobody wants to see.
But has it changed your relationship with your adopted home?
Yeah, I think so, because it has asked of anybody who's not born there, I think, to think beyond the sort of notion of America as this extraordinary place of opportunity, of freedom, of openness. All of these ideas, these concepts, have become very oddly refracted since Trump came in. You can't really believe in that stuff anymore. But there also is an awakening awareness that they need to examine themselves as a place, mm-hmm. a country that thought it knew what it was.
Yeah.
It's such a large place. It is very difficult for them not to be divided. You know, people, they trot off these ideas, oh, America's divided. You know, yeah, well, why wouldn't it be? It's so big. I mean, you fly for a couple of hours out of New York and you are in a different world.
But that division has been, you know, heightened, been more polarized than ever.
It has. It's come into focus, you know, because we're hearing probably voices we didn't care to hear before. Mm. The outcome of the election has revealed what was already there.
Yes.
But it feels good, doesn't it, to be Irish and like... I always make a joke. We have a gay Indian prime minister who is a Tory, though. And they're always like, oh, God.
Yeah, it is funny to be in a position where, like, an Irish passport is, like, gold.
And I swear, I was in the airport yesterday and someone said, oh, my God, the UK people are in a separate queue now. I think they were actually putting the UK passengers into this non-EU queue. I want them to confirm. Can we get that?
But you're right, because also Brexit has put, you know, Ireland and Irish issues front and centre in a way that never have before. Like, suddenly people know who Arlene Foster is.
But does Arlene Foster know who Arlene Foster is?
Yeah. No.
That's the big question.
I think she knows who she is.
Well, a lot of Brits are visiting Northern Ireland for the first time. They have no idea.
I don't even know if they are visiting. That's the sad thing.
Brush that from our minds. Because, Iarla, you're in America. What does America have? It has its own version of royalty, which is movie stars, and you are a movie star. Star of Brooklyn.
I don't think so.
Just so you could sing a song, a particular song, and you're going to do it for us.
Well, I'm going to do that for you, yeah.
Well, tell us about you. Give us a little bit of background there, because it's
fun. The song is actually about a barrier as well. It's an unusual kind of love song, boy meets girl love song. But he goes to the door to meet her, and mom meets him, and she makes him wind this hay rope. And by the time it's come to shape, it's gotten quite long. So he's outside the door, and then she slams the door. And then the rest of the song is quite, in some ways, typically Irish, kind of, it's ulligoning the fact that, oh, things didn't work out and he's a very old person. And yes, I did get to sing it on a movie.
Yes.
I was playing a very old man, which is not very hard for me. I was the youngest old man in a queue that walked up for dinner in a sort of a poor parish hall operating for poor people. In Brooklyn, as it were, but it was shot in Montreal.
Well, why don't you sing it for our beautiful audience here? So please welcome Iarla.
The castle Kalinda Sahuram in Wagonis Nadrom Erluib na quille is glishe of Yogrim Law. Shin Ragaru Hok Shinuum Kukuinagus Kutala Ton Sail Nagal is Boggle Mishin Sushin Bon Mahavian to a story mochri ma vien tu luam bilum os cohorti ma vien tu luam scar luam cachor luch ded chri shem vi knock nach loom de taun ik hoom arvni o de vies hal im of wach letrum var gri st de vies hal augustin hero Art lemni o de vias hal augustin roing kuig le vansa laungo luangorum chri smaviam tu luam bilum astorin mochri smaviam tu luam bilum oscorti maviam tu luam scorluam cachor luch dead cree shame of the knock nach loom de down the coom arvni is the yen of art kadahas sundua ik shame fechlok of darg of Adam hard of gwer o the khuas stach marerev ark Augustine Romutle chyren tenne van the mach ege kasum tu ganin me Maviam tu luam bilum astorin mochri Maviam tu luam bilum oscorti Maviam tu luam scorluam cachor loch dead cree shame of the knock nach loom de taunic whom arvni
thank you while listening to you there I had two thoughts. The first was a lovely thought about how it doesn't really matter that my Irish isn't good enough to get the meaning of every word. Somehow it speaks to me anyway, just my Irish soul or something. And then I remember that we used to have a gay night in Panty Bar years ago called Poor House, and people would wear bonnets and stuff and do Irish listening comprehension tests, but it'd be just like dirty stuff. And then people would like do their own Xnthony versions of things like, you know, Madonna's Like a Virgin. And I would recommend you try that sometime. You know.
Oh, that's amazing. I remembered when I was listening to it, I had totally forgotten, because when we're talking about home and home away from home, and for the most part I flip between these two places, London and Dublin, that are really close to each other, and I think, you know, I've never lost my accent, my family are here, I speak to them, I come back all of the time. But when I went to see Brooklyn in the cinema, and I've just remembered, it started and a few minutes in I had a little cry, so I had a little tear, you know, rolling down my cheek, and then the film progressed and I cried 9 more times. Like, I wept like I was, you know, being sent off on a coffin ship, like by myself, you know, with my fortune tied up in a little bindle stick. Like, it triggers something huge in me that must be a kind of an innate thing of, you know, of emigrating. And I could not believe the effect that it had on me.
Now, one of the things that you all touched on early in the first conversation, Iarla, you sort of touched on it, and also about the refugees. Was this a sort of sense of othering people or having to sort of prove your loyalty in a way or something? But it's interesting because one of the things that I find interesting about you, Mr. Roscommon, is that after Roscommon famously was the only part of the country to vote no to the same-sex marriage referendum, that you felt a sort of responsibility or a debt or something to Roscommon, because you felt that the jokes and all that were in some way being mean to Roscommon, and we were suddenly othering Roscommon. And you sort of wanted to change that perception.
I made a pop concert set in a bog.
You did, yeah.
I remember I was doing a show in Edinburgh Fringe, and it's very camp and fun about Eurovision, and afterwards a girl came up to me and was like, "Where are you from?" "I'm from Kerry." And I was like, "I'm from Roscommon." And she literally was like, "That's disgusting." I was so shocked. I was like, I can't speak to you now. This is too much. She said, "I'm from the real west of Ireland, Kerry." So I don't know what was going on with her.
But she was just trying to interact.
I know. And then at the same time, I'd found my confirmation booklet, and you know, some sort of things were kind of lining up, and I thought, oh, this would be a really interesting kind of thing, explore my home being queer in rural Ireland and kind of reinvent those things that we all kind of are bored of, you know, like fairies and things that we kind of are kind of cliched. And I was like, yeah, let's make them gay. And
you wanted
that
to make fairies gay?
Yeah.
Oh, really? Big challenge.
But you did go back to Roscommon and your old school, and you're like,
it wasn't a passing thought. It was quite traumatizing, really. Like, I found it very hard, and making the show is very personal. And like, I was going back to places where I was 8 years old and a teacher, I was being bullied for being, I didn't even know what gay was, but I got pulled out, and the guys that were saying you're gay were pulled out as well. And she just turned to me and went like, are you gay? I was 8 years old. Like, so I went back, and that person may or may not still be there and may not have seen the show. And we recorded the music for the show. The kids recorded the choir and all sorts of stuff, and we recorded in the same space that had happened. And like, it was really, for me, even after doing the show in Dublin Fringe, it's going to Edinburgh Fringe this year as well, everyone.
But you know, so when you tell your story, it sounds like you were just like out of Roscommon, you were going to London, it's your big candy box of opportunity and all of that. And yet, yeah, you did dedicate a lot of your time and your work to sort of trying to, I don't know, rehabilitate the image of Roscommon.
And I kind of stopped now, because I couldn't get into a bloody club at Christmas time, because I was like, my trainers were not. My neighbor came out and was like, well, if you can't afford good shoes, then you can't, which was like code for gay, you know, like you can't. And I'm like, all the stuff that I've done for you.
You put Roscommon on the map.
I continue to do so. But, and they're very Roscommon County Council are really supportive. They funded the show, and I've gone back and I've made like a podcast with like 8-year-old kids. And
it was the podcast, you just asking them all if they're gay.
Are you gay? This is what we ask 8-year-olds in Roscommon.
So I basically like let the kids tell me their stories. There was one girl who just talked about Charlie the Tree, and she was like, Charlie the Tree is real. He's been chopped down and he's talking to me and he's saying that he really misses his arms. But I just sort of let the kids talk, and there was all these mad characters, and we created an alternate reality called The Third Mountain.
I'm not buying this London thing at all. You're going to be back in Roscommon.
Yeah.
You know,
I need to give up.
Your relationship with Roscommon is still unhealthy. That's what I'm saying.
My mother is actually from Roscommon, and she spoke about...
But she
grew up on a farm, and she talked about that desire to want to escape, but also thinking that America was just over the mountain in front of their farm, and that desire from when she was probably the age of the children that you're working with, but just to go, to leave. And the complication in a way of coming back, and the complexity, you know, of the emotions that it stirs in terms of belonging and family, but also, yeah, just that desire to leave as well, that I think continues in some ways. I work with both teenagers and small children in Ireland these days around development education and sort of human rights. But I was just thinking in relation to children, like my experience, particularly of teenagers in Ireland these days, is that they're amazing. They're deeply politicized, they're empathetic, they're engaged, critically analytical, and they are so confident of grassroots sort of action. So I think a lot of a room for and development, for just a really creative outlet for a lot of ideas with young people.
But what's your impression of Ireland now?
It's mixed. I feel a level of concern and unease that I haven't felt in the 7 years that I've been back over the last year, in terms of with the burning of the direct provision hostels in Ruski and other contexts. I see that amongst a lot of young people that I work with. The vast majority are amazing. They're empathetic, they're engaged, but there has been this seeping populism.
Yeah.
But on a personal level, I'm very happy here. I have a lovely community of friends, and I work with amazing people. But I think a lot of the accounts that I'm hearing from refugee and asylum-seeking communities are deeply worrying. And whether that is overt in terms of hate crime, whether that is just sort of the everyday, quote-unquote, more casualized racism, and no, racism is casualized in the sense of
like
the violence of
racism.
Its impact. Yes.
Because in a way, it's the flip side, isn't it, this idea of home, that then there are these people who sort of, to an extreme, start defending it as their home and not anyone else's. But I'm interested in, so Brona, you're in London, and it's one of the great international cities, because everybody from everywhere is there. Do you feel, well, that racism has become more of an issue, or is that all in our heads?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting time. Like, the lovely thing about London is I live in Walthamstow, which is in East London, and, you know, there's a really long, famous market there, and it feels like you can walk from one side of that market up to the top, which is about a 20-minute walk, and you will have heard, I don't know, 30 languages. But that's my favourite thing about London. And definitely now, there is, I guess it's a state of limbo at the moment, because people just really genuinely don't know what is coming. meaning or what it means, if there's practical implications, if they will actually be deported, if there's visas to be applied for. And so, you know, it is just a little bit of a time of tension. I personally haven't experienced racism. You know, I'm a white Irish person. Yeah. And it feels like racism comes from systems of power. There's no system of power that oppresses white people. So, but I definitely think that, like, when my partner and I go outside of London to go for a walk, you suddenly start to see a lot more BNP flags and UKIP flags that you don't see in London, which is why you're reminded that there is kind
it's
of this
world.
Other, it's a, yeah, there's
totally
this other
world.
Part of England that wants to make England something that London, by its very nature, is the exact opposite of. So it is this kind of tension of trying to make a country, you know, you're arguing with reality, really. Like, if you're saying, you know, international people can't be in London, but London exists and is a city of international people, then, yeah, you know, what is going to happen?
Do you feel that, Anthony?
We're very much free pass Irish, play up the Irish thing. It's fresh for them now. We're like, cool. You know, I think we live in a bubble in London. We're not. I remember some friends of mine had like gone to Yorkshire to do some training for a job they were doing, and it was a clothing job, and it was a totally different vibe. The, you know, men wouldn't fold the clothing. That's the women. You know, there was, and it, the racism was really thick. I don't see it in front of me.
Yeah, I did have an experience on the tube just 2 days ago where there was a big leave march in London.
Yeah. Oh,
and
yeah.
I got onto the tube and there was four guys who had leave stickers on.
Tattooed to their face.
And one of them sort of shuffled up so that I could lean beside him on the thing, and I made a joke like, oh, you're so good at sharing. And so, you know, he kind of started talking to me, and he was very sweetly talking about his stepdaughter who lived in another country and how she was his whole world. And I was like, oh, she's lucky to have you. And we were just having a kind of human connection moment, which doesn't often happen on the tube.
Yeah.
And then he just immediately turned around and used a racial slur for the traveling community and said something really offensive. And I was like, oh, I don't know what to do now, because I've been like actively, loudly being friendly to you. And now you've said this thing that's made me very uncomfortable and kind of, you know, reinforced the unconscious bias that I was trying to challenge. So I need to go put this.
Like, Iarla, when I lived abroad, the things that I missed mostly were being able to have casual, easy conversations with people with references that we all understood. So, you know, if you're Irish here, we can talk about Wanderley Wagon and Bosco, stupid stuff that, you know, individually is nothing. But if you are living in a place where you can never make those casual references and you constantly have to, oh no, there's no point saying that. That was the thing that made me start to question, could I live there forever?
Yeah, because you know, when you go to a place first, there's a sort of a fascination, isn't there?
Mm.
I remember when I first went to where I live in the States, I fell in love with one house on a particular street. I had no connection to that house, but I wanted that house. And I was then kind of looking at it every day and then imagining what it would be like to actually be in that house and be that person on that street and inside that town, near that city, in that land. It, to be even understood sometimes in these places is an incomplete sort of phenomenon.
Yeah.
I find a tendency in myself to play up my Irishness, which I try to dampen, because I can be the funny guy, you know what I mean?
Yeah. But you're
at
also a
party
singer. I mean, like,
yeah,
you know.
But they don't know what that is for the most part. I mean, you know, Xnthony didn't even exist as a word internationally until very recently, if it does now. But, like, I often find sometimes, like, the Irish guy, you know. One of the first times I went to Princeton, I met a composer, and he said, hey, you're the Irish guy, because he'd met me before. But I tend not to worry about those things anymore. I mean, I like to talk about people, about the things that they want to talk about.
Yeah.
The things that we have in common, which is music making for the most part. There's not a whole lot of discussion about politics or even identity in that sense. There is a fascination with Ireland, however, which I find the Americans have, even though you'll meet mostly people who aren't of Irish extraction. They still seem to... They know more about Ireland than we deserve.
Well, I mean, there's also a sense that we will lazily accuse British and American people of being disinterested in the rest of the world. It's a kind of a cliche, but it is also true. Now, you can find reasons for it and say, why do 50% of Americans not have a passport? Well, their country is so huge, you know, they don't really... And we live in a little rock, and you could row a boat to another country. It's an entirely different way of seeing the world. And we are forced to look outwards. And we are also forced to look at bigger, you know, more powerful, looming cultures and nations that are, you know, because we know it's going to affect, you know, what happens there will affect us. Whereas they don't give a crap what happens in Ireland. You know, why should they? But it is still true that many Americans are not interested in learning about the rest of the world.
Again, it depends on where you are, you know. I mean, yes. The nearest city to me is New York. So, like, they're interested in everything and nothing at the same time. They're very interested in themselves.
And could you live there?
I could. New York's fascinating.
You, I mean, if you, you could get over like, the yes, noise. I could.
Yeah, I could, because I spend a lot of time in there anyway, working and stuff. I think, like you were saying earlier, it's great to be in a city where you can melt into nothingness and just be the person that you really are. Rather than, oh, you're so-and-so and you have to be that guy because of where you came from.
Yes.
No, I'm so-and-so because of what I do and how I think and what I have to say. In places like New York and London, you can find the part of yourself that I think Ireland tends to diminish in the bigger space.
Yeah.
And I think, I don't know if that resonates for you guys.
Well, it's so funny because I've lived in London for 6 years and that kind of like, ooh, it's so exciting, has totally worn off. But when I went to New York 2 weeks ago, I was back wearing makeup on my face. I was in my jumpsuit. I was like, I am here. New York is amazing. But then, of course, we don't have to deal with Trump. So, you know, we're like tourists over in this new place. But it is...
There's so many scenes in New York, you know. Mm-hmm. So many, and they're complete. I mean, these places are very alienating too. That is a fact.
Yeah.
Would I be happy to move there tomorrow? I live half the year in Kilkenny. You can't even see a house from my house. Not one. I've tried. Believe me. You cannot see anything except trees and stuff. And I love that.
Yeah.
I mean, I do.
Well, that's also, the thing about people trying to put you in a box or having to be one identity only.
No, I think that's a really valid point. I think we're much more in between as creatures than we allow ourselves. I mean, I have three teenage kids now. And they allow themselves anything and everything. In the way they think. Certainly, I think compared to when I was growing up, they have far, far more color in their visual range than I appeared to have. I think I was very monochrome, to chime with what you said earlier.
Well, but at the moment then, there's this push from ethno-nationalists and all sorts for everybody to pick an identity and stick with it. And I'm like, no, the whole point of...
Yeah, there's something kind of inherently confusing in a way for me about this conversation, because on the one hand, there's like a bit of my brain that believes, oh my God, we drew all these lines down this globe and we completely made it up.
Yep.
And like, you know, sure, some tectonic plates shifted or, you know, I'm no scientist. But, you know, the country's formed, but then there are also loads of borders that are completely, you know, made by humans. And I'm sure you would agree in terms of your work, Caoimhe, like we've become really obsessed with how we allow people to move over those borders to the detriment of their safety and their health and their life. And so, you know, there's a part of me that thinks that it's also nuts. We've constructed it. We've completely made it up. What the hell is a country? And then there's another part of me that's like, cut me open and I'll bleed green. Yeah, like I'm Irish to my core. Or I will arm wrestle you if you say...
But you can believe both things at the same time.
Well, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
You know, they're not actually contradictory.
You're right.
I believe that till the day I die, you know, you'll cut me open and I'll be Irish.
Yeah.
But I can be Irish anywhere I want to be.
Yeah.
And home is me. So who cares where it is,
as
long as I'm happy there?
Home is where I've, like, signed in on Netflix on the telly.
Exactly. And can I have your account?
Although we were talking about earlier, like, you were mentioning that you listen to radio.
I'm known as, in London, they call me Marion Finucane.
Yeah.
Because I was in Barcelona last June and I was doing Marion Finucane. I was explaining to my Irish friends what the hell was happening in Ireland. They don't have a... I'm kind of obsessed with everything that's happening.
Most of the rest of the world does not wake up to the kind of radio that we wake up to.
Oh, it's... There's a... Like,
they're just the way talking they speak. You know, it's fun.
I do exactly the same. Like, when I get up in the morning, I can listen back to Sean O'Rourke straight away.
I love Sean.
And then, you know, on Saturday, because that's what I do every Saturday in Ireland. So I kind of recreate that in my apartment. I kind of have late breakfast.
Oh, my God, Marion Finucane is
that's
home.
That's bizarre.
We've cracked it.
We brought her here. She's coming in.
She's
Marion
it, Finucane yeah.
is the answer. She's it.
But it's funny because you're kind of inflating a kind of a bubble there that isn't real in a sense. Or I'm saying this about myself, to create a sensation of home or some semblance of home.
Well, Also, it's because Irish people, we have this amazing ability to talk, and also they're very good at analysing things, and compared to the British at the moment, like, there is no conversation happening in Britain.
But we are going to finish this up with another song from Iarla. You're like going to create a feeling of home for us all.
Oh, maybe not.
Speak to our Irish souls.
This is just a very small song called Sour Sour.
Sour, sour, binding on them. Hogamer fain and souring. Sour, a bween and nodding glegal. The hogamer fain and souring. Hogamer ling, oh, he'll craving. Hogamer fain and souring. Sour a bwee all the grainin. Shall hogamer fain and souring. Quillin is call as traum is quarrin. Hogamer fain and souring. Is call is traum is quarrin. Hogamer fain and souring. An fuin seo gleagal bail an áthair. Shall hogamer fain and souring. Saura, saura, bangin an aunan. Hogamer fain and souring. Sour a bwee all evening grainin, the hogamer fain and souring. Hogamer ling e ochil crevig, hogamer fain and souring. Sour a bwee all evening grainin. Fain and souring.
Thank you, Iarla. That is it from us in this episode of Pantisocracy. You can catch up on this and every other episode of Pantisocracy via podcast. And you can, if you go to pantisocracy.ie, you can get links to those and also videos of all the performances and stuff. So just finally, I want to say thanks again to all of my guests, Iarla Ó Lionáird, Brona Titley, Anthony Keigher, and Caoimhe Butterly. And thank you so much for being with us, and thanks for our studio audience, and thank you at home for listening. Join us next time. Bye-bye.